Welcome to episode 197 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent on a mission to show the public who the FBI is and what the FBI does through my books, my blog, and my podcast case reviews with former colleagues. Today, we get to speak to retired agent Nancy Savage, who served in the FBI for 34 years, 28 as a special agent. Prior to graduating from the FBI Academy, she was employed in the personnel division at FBI headquarters. During her agent career, Nancy worked as a street agent in the Louisville, Miami, and Portland divisions, and as a supervisor in the Miami and Portland divisions, as well as a unit chief in the Criminal Investigative Division at FBI headquarters. In this episode, Nancy reviews the life and career of retired FBI agent Robert Levinson and the 13-year fight to bring Bob home. Bob Levinson had not been seen publicly or heard from since March 9th of 2007, when he was kidnapped while visiting Kish Island in Iran. Nancy was involved with the FBI's Employee Assistance Program, EAP, for most of her career. She retired from the FBI as the Supervisory Senior Resident Agent in Eugene, Oregon. During her assignment in Oregon, she served from 1999 to 2001 as the Western Regional Representative of the FBI Agents Association and as the National President from 2001 to 2003. Currently, Nancy is the Executive Director of the Society of Former Special Agents of the FBI, a fraternal, educational, and community-minded organization with the mission to preserve shared FBI values, to support the welfare of members through service, benefits, and career networking, to offer programs of fellowship, education, service, and history, and to promote the FBI and law enforcement national security communities. The campaign to bring Bob home and find out the truth about the disappearance of Robert Levinson, What About Bob?, has been the Society's focus for the past 13 years. Recently, the Levinson family announced that they had received information from U.S. officials that has led them to conclude that their wonderful husband and father died while in Iranian custody. Nancy and I recorded this episode with the approval of the family and the Society of Former Special Agents of the FBI. For more information about Bob Levinson, please refer to the family's Facebook page, Help Bob Levinson, or the website, helpboblevinson.com. I wanted to post this episode during the month of March to participate in the annual Missing Man campaign with the Levinson family and my FBI colleagues. I'm going to still post an episode this Wednesday. Another reason I'm posting two episodes this week is to show my appreciation for you continuing to listen to the show. I've heard from other podcasters that their numbers are down. As of now, mine remain the same, so thanks for listening. I also want to thank everyone who went out and purchased my newest book, FBI Word Search Puzzles, Fun for Armchair Detectives. The book was the number one new release for word search books and word game books on Amazon. It's also available at Barnes & Noble and wherever books are sold. There is a link in your podcast app's description of this episode that will take you to more information about the book. There's also a link to where new listeners, welcome, can go to join my reader team, where I keep you up to date on the FBI in books, TV, and movies via my monthly email. Launch team members, don't forget to leave your review. Thank you, everyone. Now here's the show. I want to welcome my guest, Nancy Savage. Hi, Nancy.
Hi, Jerry. Happy to be here.
Well, I'm a member of the Society of Former Special Agents of the FBI, their Information Committee. And earlier this month, we had decided as a committee to try to get as much information out about Bob Levinson, you know, out to the media, out to the public. One of the things that I volunteered to do was to have somebody come on FBI Retired Case File Review to talk about Bob, not just about his disappearance, which we'll get into, but about Bob the man, Bob the special agent, Bob the father and the husband. And so we had arranged to do that earlier this week. And because of technical difficulties, we weren't able to do it. And in between the time that we had initially scheduled this and today, when we're actually doing it, a lot of things have changed. So why don't we start off with you talking about what has changed, then tell us a little bit more. We'll go to the very beginning about what happened to Bob. And then I thought we would stop for a little bit. You tell us about who Bob is. And then we'll go back and fill in the timeline as to everything that's happened. How does that sound?
That sounds great, Jerry.
All right. Well, why don't you talk about the announcement? I know you wrote a press release with the approval of the family. And I should say that this interview today, this episode today, is also with the approval of the family. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what was announced in this press release?
Well, the press release was released last night, and I think it's still being released by different members of our information committee. You know, essentially what happened on Wednesday evening at about 5 o'clock, the Levinson family made a press release that indicated that the U.S. government had information in their possession recently, just in the last month, and they shared that information with the Levinson family, that there's information to believe that Bob Levinson, who'd been in custody of Iranian government for 13 years, passed away some time ago while still in Iranian custody. And of course, this is just heartrending to the family that has worked for 13 years to try to bring Bob home to his family after he was captured by the Iranian Revolutionary Guard 13 years ago on Kish Island in 2007. Kish Island is a portion of Iran. The family obviously had worked with the U.S. government and the FBI, all of the intelligence agency, including the Central Intelligence Agency, for a number of years to bring Bob home. And the U.S. government had worked through other diplomatic channels, since we don't have formal diplomatic relations with Iran, to try to negotiate a release of Bob. And of course, this was always complicated by the fact that the Iranian officials had never admitted until January of this year that they had any information whatsoever about Bob Levinson, other than the initial reports coming out of Iran the day or two after Bob went missing there. So it was a difficult nut to work on diplomatically, with no one admitting they had the hostage. And the family, of course, has been distraught. Their statement that they gave to the press Wednesday evening, they had called a number of members of the society that had worked on this personally for years, different family members, just to give us a heads up so we could be prepared for it, which we appreciated. His wife, Christine, has led this charge for years. They have 7 children. Bob is very much a family man. And so their statement really indicates that although there is some degree of relief in terms of their efforts to bring Bob home, because they know he's no longer here on this earth, there is closure that has been denied to him, because they do not Half its remains have not been released. The Iranian government hasn't made a formal statement. They don't know what happened to Bob from the time he was taken until he passed away. They don't even know the exact date. They learned that it's some time ago. It was before the pandemic occurred. There's some indication that he was alive up until early in 2016. So that narrows down the time frame that he could have been passed away. But the Iranian government officials that were responsible for this, you know, are still unknown, and they have not been held accountable for the illegal taking of Bob and his custody and all that's involved with that.
Well, I know you had mentioned the pandemic, and it sounds like that had something to do with the announcement of the fact that most likely, you know, he is deceased. Could you talk about that a little bit more?
Well, this is Nancy surmising, and, you know, I followed this case pretty much from the time it was announced that he was missing, because I know Bob, I know his family, we were assigned together in Miami. So my feeling on this is that the pressure has continually been ramped up by the U.S. government, definitely more in the last couple of years. Secretary Pompeo with the State Department increased the pressure because the FBI had a $5 million reward since 2015 for any information seeking Bob. And then just in the last year, the State Department added $20 million to reward to information leading to Bob, knowledge of his whereabouts and recovery. I believe that there was just a tremendous amount of pressure to get him back, especially when there was word not only that Iran is one of the nations last, I checked a couple days ago, and of course everything is evolving with COVID-19, but Iran was the third country most impacted by China, Italy, and then Iran. I think the U.S. is kind of overtaking some of that now, but they're heavily impacted. We don't even know. The numbers are bad. They're probably not even accurate numbers. And what was going on in the overcrowded prisons is well known to the world. And they were releasing some other U.S. citizens. They released one, a Navy veteran, Michael White, in March, released him to the Swiss embassy, at least furloughed him, and released some other prisoners, foreign prisoners, as well as their own prisoners, furloughed them or released them, trying to uncrowd the prisons a little bit. And of course, this was making the U.S. government and the family understandably frantic to try to get Bob out of there. So my sense is COVID-19 was making a situation in Iran, you know, almost untenable. They've been under a terrible economic decline and been impacted very seriously by the economic sanctions put on by the current administration. And everything has been heightened in terms of the fact that Iran is still sending missiles over to Iraq, or in other terms, using their proxy terrorists that are in Iraq that they're funding to continue assaulting Iraqi forces. So all of that is just an explosive situation, and the pressure was being cranked up on Iran to release Bob and get that out of the way in terms of any kind of negotiations going forward to try to, I can't say normalize situations, but at least ratchet it down a little bit between the U.S. and Iran. So we've got that situation going, and whatever, I'm not privy to the exact methodology of how the information was released, but the U.S. government believes it, and the Levinson family now believes it, that Bob passed away sometime probably in the last few years, because we do have some intelligence indicating he was alive and potentially was going to be traded in early 2016 when five other hostages were released as Iran. And that didn't happen for some political reasons, according to the intelligence that we have. they decided there was no political advantage to releasing Bob at that time because they had never admitted that they had him, had denied it for a number of years. So now the family correctly, and our society has pivoted in terms of what they would like. It's still a quest. They want to find out where Bob was, how he was living for the time he was taken till how he passed away, and also definitely would like to have his remains returned for burial to the United States and to his family, and to have those officials who were responsible held responsible.
Well, there are certainly a lot of unknowns, but there are some knowns, some things that we do know about in more detail about Bob's assignment and what he was doing there. But before we even get into that, because we do have a timeline that the family has on their website that provides some details. And also, I know you've written an article that will be published soon in The Grapevine, which is the Society's monthly magazine. But before we get into those details, I thought it would be a great time, almost a memorial to Bob Levinson, to talk about him. You did know Bob. You mentioned, you know, a few things about Bob and being on your squad. So can we talk about when he joined the FBI and the assignments that he had?
Well, yeah, I know Bob. He was a DEA agent in New York, I believe, for 6 years prior to joining the FBI. I believe he was assigned to Denver as an FBI agent for a number of years and then assigned to New York after that. I know in New York, he became kind of an expert on organized crime officials. He definitely worked on the intelligence side, always pretty much on criminal matters, but on the intelligence side, developing intelligence about criminal enterprises. In New York, he really worked on chronicling the five families, the five major organized crime families. And then he was eventually assigned down into our FBI's Miami division where I met him. He eventually got assigned on my squad where I was a drug supervisor down there in terms of the criminal drug intelligence in Miami. And Bob had taken his expertise on the intelligence side. And when he got down to Miami, he realized, and this was in the 1980s, early 1980s, he realized while the FBI had achieved concurrent jurisdiction on Title 21 matters, which is U.S. government criminal code with DEA, that the FBI was working drug cases based on that concurrent jurisdiction, but they really didn't know who the cartel members were and what their hierarchy was and how everything interacted. And he realized to be effective in terms of targeting our resources in the FBI that we needed to outline the cartels and who were the big guys, who were the important ones, who were the not so important, who was aspiring and really good intelligence. And Bob took his expertise with chronicling the mob, so to speak, from New York, and he applied that to the Colombian cocaine cartels. And he was a phenomenal interviewer. He's very good at developing sources of information. He was good at putting that information, writing it up and putting it on paper. And he essentially started going around to all the prisons where we had individuals convicted of drug offenses, cocaine primarily, but some marijuana at the time, and interviewing them just like we do. It's probably more notorious that people are aware that hey, we interview people who are in jail for some of these mass murders or those type of situations, but just sort of a debrief of what they did and how they did it and all that kind of stuff.
Sounds like he was building a profile, just like the profilers in the behavioral analysis
unit. Yeah, to a certain extent, but it was more like, hey, the profile of the organization. Who are the big guys? Who are the little guys? Who are the distributors? Where was their production? the cartels definitely had a structure, and, you know, no one had put that down on paper before or figured it out or charted it out. And that's what Pop did. He became well known nationally and even internationally with his ability to do that, and he carried it over to some other criminal problems. But, you know, when I was working with Bob, he really made a difference in how the FBI targeted their research and how we were able to figure out how we could best attack these organizations rather than just doing hit and miss cases and putting our resources over someone that would not be as significant as someone else that was over here that we knew about, but we hadn't penetrated that organization. So it was pretty phenomenal work. You know, he was known in the Miami division. He was known by first name. He was known by Bobby. What's Bobby up to? What's he doing now? What's he up to? He's got a line on something. You know, that's how everyone knew him.
Well, it sounds like the work that he did was something that was not only usable during the period of time that he was on your squad, but he developed, I guess, a structure, a foundation for work to continue to fill in those gaps.
Exactly. I mean, he started it when he was working on a regular drug squad, you know, down in Miami, working for Tim McNally. I think Tim had the foresight to listen to him and say, yeah, Bob, let's pull you off cases and just have you work on figuring this out. And then we'll be better able to target our resources. And then that became sort of the model. It actually became the model for the entire FBI because Miami pioneered a sort of a criminal intelligence squad, the whole concept of that. And it really started out of Bob's work.
And of the 22 years that he was in the FBI, how many did he spend in Miami? And I take it he retired out of the Miami division?
Yeah, I'm not sure. Probably the majority of his career would have been spent there from the early 80s till probably later 90s. So, you know, the majority of his career was there, although he spent a significant amount of time up in New York.
While he was there, he really built a beautiful family. He said he had seven kids.
Seven kids, and he was always known as a family man. Christine, his wife, very close relationship, and the children were the apple of his eye. You know, this has been just devastating to them from the time he went over there and disappeared.
I didn't know Bob, but, you know, over the years, learning about him and seeing pictures of him and his beautiful family, I think one of the saddest things that I feel now that I'm a grandparent, you know, I've got two and one on the way, and I think about his 11 grandchildren. I take it that many of them, if not most of them, because he's been gone 13 years, have never had a chance to meet their grandfather. And that is just...
That is true. That is just heartbreaking. And, you know, Bob was one of those agents that people would describe as bigger than life. I mean, he was tall. He was a presence. Like I said, there's not that many agents that are known just by their first name. And, you know, especially in a big division like Miami, he was definitely a force to be reckoned with at work. And I'm sure he was at home as well. He retired in the late 90s and began he had been doing work for quite a while as an independent contractor and intelligence type work and investigative type work for individuals. He had quite a bit of time. You know, it's common practice, you retire and go into some other kind of occupation, especially when the kids are getting older, going to college, getting married, all those kind of things.
I had my post FBI job that I worked for 7 years.
Right.
You know, we all do because, you know, basically with mandatory retirement of 57, most agents leave in their early 50s so that they are more marketable to get a post-FBI job. And I know that many, many of the agents that I've spoken to on FBI Retired Case File Review have gone overseas, have taken these contractor jobs. I know of one right now that's over in Afghanistan, and I'm sure there's many, many more all over the world who have retired and are taking these contractor jobs. So that is something that is very normal for the FBI to do because they have those investigative skills. And whether you're working drug investigations or terrorism investigations, most of those skills are transferable, wouldn't you say?
Yes, they are. I mean, we operate in the society, a very vibrant career center, because there's a huge demand for the skills of FBI agents, active duty and retired, by private industry.
And I did mention this when I read your bio at the beginning of the episode, but I do want to emphasize that you were at one time the president of the society. What is your role? Do you have an official role with them?
I am actually the executive director, so it's a paid position. We have a headquarters office in Dumfries, Virginia. You know, we have like 115 chapters around the country, but we've got a number of paid positions in our headquarters here in Virginia. So I'm the executive director, the CEO of the Society of Former Special Agents, as well as our charitable foundation, Former Agents of the FBI Foundation. Now, I was never the president, never an officer. I basically retired and then this job got advertised and I put in for it. I was president of the active duty FBI agents.
Okay.
Yeah, gotta correct that.
Yes, okay. Yeah. I see here, the FBI Agents Association, who we've also have had on the show, a representative. You were their national president from 2001, 2003. So we'll get that correct. And the society does great, great work. I was the vice president of the Charles Reed Philadelphia chapter for a number of years. I'm currently the secretary for Philadelphia. And the only reason I brought that up is because this is an organization for retired and former special agents of the FBI. So when something happens to one of our members, like Bob Levinson, the group comes together to support the actual member and the member's family. Could you talk a little bit about what the society has done in order to assist the family in their efforts to bring Bob home?
Right. The society, Bob is a member. So, you know, we're the former agents of the FBI, but we also, just to clarify that, we do have almost 1,000 active duty FBI agents that are associate members, but it's primarily for former agents of the FBI. And Bob was one of our members who had retired from the FBI. He was a regular member for a number of years when he went missing. And so as that, you know, he's a member in distress. And that's when our former agents, our affiliated organization that we also take care of here out of our headquarters, our former agent foundation jumps in along with the society because they have a member assistance program. So we help our members out financially and otherwise if they've got some kind of problems that would fall within our mandate for that foundation. So I've said for a number of years, and that's, you know, I think our board of directors feels the same way, definitely our presidents, that there's no more member assistance case more important or more significant than Bob Levinson has been. So, you know, we worked with the family to try to get public awareness of Bob's situation. There's been legislation introduced, you know, the senators and representatives, U.S. senators and representatives in Florida have been very supportive of trying to get Bob back. So we helped with the legislation, getting co-sponsors to it. Also, the foundation has given some college scholarships to several of his children. And the idea is just to let them know they're not in there alone. We've always got their backs on this. We also meet with managers and the director at the FBI and let them know that is our primary number one issue for years, is to try to bring Bob back. Our chapters every March, which is the anniversary of when Bob has been taken, honor Bob. They set missing man tables. They have banners. They wear pins. We issue press releases to keep his name out there in the public knowledge. We send out our members to meet with every member of Congress individually and make sure they're aware that Bob's missing, what his plight is, and also get them to co-sponsor various bills that have been introduced in Congress. So I can't think of anything that is a higher priority in both the society and the foundation. And this is probably one of the cruelest things. It would be one thing to have someone in custody, which, you know, the Red Cross could visit or you can openly talk about, but the fact that he was taken and they never would admit it is probably the cruelest situation for this family, to know that Bob was over there and taken, but not have any way to communicate with him or even effectively communicate about him. That is our priority. And even though we're pivoting to a few changed things, we're not going to drop this mantle or this quest to get the information that's needed, hold those people accountable.
And to bring Bob home.
Yeah, bring Bob's remains home.
I would like to take some time now to talk about why Bob was there and what we do know. And what we do know is that Bob Levinson is the longest held hostage in U.S. history. We talked about so many agents who have taken post-FBI jobs to go overseas to work with different agencies. And I think that it has been confirmed at this time. You can tell me if it's confirmed or not, but that he was over there as an assignment for the intelligence side, the analytical side of the CIA.
You know, I've read the reports and, you know, have to believe that's true. He was over there as an independent contractor doing some work for them, and that essentially he was working on the analytical side. It's been documented that a number of people have been disciplined and even removed from their positions with the agency over how this was handled, and there wasn't the appropriate approvals for Bob to be in such a risky situation without any kind of backup to get him out of there, or even the appropriate knowledge of the agency.
And I think it's important, because when we talk about Iran not acknowledging that Bob was there or that they held Bob, there is concrete proof that Bob was there. I mean, I read that the family was able to verify on the manifest of the flight of him arriving
in
Kish Island. And also they found his registration at the hotel where he stayed overnight before he went missing.
It confirmed that he was there. There was also initial reporting that he was taken by the intelligence service over there, and then he was in the custody of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard, and then there was no knowledge. All the information dried up after that. Initially, they thought, oh, he's been taken into custody, but he's going to be released, and then all information dried up.
And that's strange, because I take it that any other situation, when a hostage is taken officially by a government or representatives of a government, they acknowledge that. And there's a trial and there's information that's put out about what this person has allegedly done wrong or illegally in that country. And that just didn't happen in this case.
No, it didn't. So I don't know why that didn't happen. I don't really have knowledge of that. And of course, as the situation unfolded, once you start denying it, it's like any other lie. It's hard to go back on it.
Yeah. And I do think another thing that I read, and I've looked at lots of articles and lots of videos from news agencies that reported on Bob, and many of those with the cooperation of the family. And one of the other things I learned is that Bob had files and records that they were able to review to show the work that he was doing for this analytical group of the CIA. So all of that is really based in fact.
Right. Right. I mean, Bob was there. Bob was taken into custody, and now we're getting confirmation enough that the U.S. government, including everyone involved at a high level with the administration in the intelligence field, believes it's confirmation that he was there and he died a few years ago. The information that's been shared with the family makes them believe that too. So that's a given now. So now we're pivoting. It's just awful. This family had been sort of dragged along for some reason or another, unbeknownst to me anyway. The family received proof of life of Bob in 2010, and the
Can you talk
government,
a little bit about that?
2010, 2011, his family received several proof of life, some video and photographs, email indicating he was alive. The video was begging for him to be returned, but there was no demand for payment or anything else. And this was all at a time that the Iranian government kept saying that they didn't have him. So that's still sort of a mystery as to what was going on there. The U.S. government examined the video and the proof of life, and they believed it was professionally done by some type of intelligence service. And now, of course, we're learning that he was taken into custody by the Iranian government, and then he died in their custody. It would tend to make you believe that those proof of life, he was in custody at that time in Iran. That, of course, was just, again, additionally heartbreaking to the family to get a video with Bob asking to come home and please bring me back, and then no way to be able to negotiate to make that happen. Of course, it was very disappointing in January 2016 when the Obama administration had negotiated the release of a number of Americans, five Americans from Iran. And disappointingly, we didn't know what the names were. We were waiting for a couple days, and then Bob was not one of them. It was just another heartbreak to the family and all of his friends and everyone who's been working on this case. The FBI's had an active case since the time he was taken. You know, they have a huge task force that's still operational working on it, and representatives from all the government agencies and intelligence services. This has been high priority with the U.S. government, the FBI, and the intelligence community. So again, that was just another heartbreaker. And now, based on other intelligence they received, as I said earlier, the thinking was the Iranian government was going to get something from the release of the five Americans. But Bob, if they had released him at that time, it wouldn't have worked out well for them politically.
Do we even think that maybe Bob was not alive back then?
Well, the intelligence that I'm in possession of or have read about indicates that they were considering it. So that would make you believe that he was alive at that time. But they pulled away from it for political reasons because, hey, you now release someone you said you didn't have. So they were hoping for some good political mileage out of releasing the five Americans, and then Bob would have potentially taken away from that. I don't see that in my mind, but that's the intelligence that we have. Just recently, this year, the Iranian government did admit, this was pretty much a game changer, everyone was ramping up. They admitted, in the UN that they have an ongoing case concerning Bob. Now, of course, that was after 12 plus years, that was just considered a game changer, because why would they release that officially, that they have a case, and when they didn't acknowledge any knowledge of him? So my sense of that, and that's Nancy's sense, is, again, they were realizing he's a political liability in terms of being able to negotiate anything with the United States as far as sanctions, et cetera, that were creating havoc with them. In terms of Bob was always on the table, and they no longer could produce him. There was also a more accurate translation of some Iranian documents that the government had had, which confirmed this case. So this really ramped up everyone's efforts to get him home. Now we realize the progression of what was going on between Bob, the U.S. government, and the Iranian government is information developed that he's passed away. So we can't negotiate for Bob's return home other than now we can negotiate for his remains, what happened to him, et cetera. The case hasn't gone away and it's still there. It's very important, but it definitely has changed the focus and it's pivoted. Of course, everyone knows of Iran taking over the embassy, Tehran, and they've been taking hostages for a number of years and, you know, using them as a number of countries do for either negotiating tools or financial tools. And, you know, this is just another one of their, you know, continued hostages. He was probably considered a very significant person to have in their possession.
Well, as you said, the campaign to bring Bob home hasn't ended. You know, of course, they still want to bring back his body. So for anyone who wants to continue to follow up on this case, I would suggest that you refer to the family's Facebook page, Help Bob Levison, or their website, helpboblevison.com.
And there are several pieces of legislation that are still active. I mean, the legislation is really designed to try to hold Iran more accountable. And essentially, there's a bill in the House of Representatives, H.R. 1611, introduced by Ted Deutch in Florida, Representative Ted Deutch. And it gives a lot more sanctions against essentially for any kind of hostage situation. It's not just Iran, but any kind of hostage-taking accountability, and it's been named for Bob, and it was introduced in March 7th, a year ago, 2019, and it's known as the Robert Levison Hostage Recovery and Hostage-Taking Accountability Act, and it basically puts a lot of sanctions on any government involved in hostage-taking. There's a companion Senate bill, 712, and it was essentially introduced by Senators Marco Rubio in Florida and Bob Menendez in New Jersey under the same name and basically similar type sanctions that would be part of that bill. So we're trying to get everyone to continue to co-sponsor that because we don't need to have any other hostages taken. And there needs to be real sanctions. It's just the world becoming smaller all the time. And these bad players don't need to be rewarded for what they're doing.
We're looking at the safety of other agents like Bob who are trying to do work for, you know, our government and different companies overseas. And their safety is definitely paramount in those efforts. I want to thank you, Nancy, for coming on the show to talk to us about Bob Levison. I think this is just a really important time for us to make sure that the public knows the full story about Bob and that we don't forget Bob.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me, Jerry. It's an honor.
One of the things I do on this show is not only highlight FBI cases and in this case, you know, an FBI agent, but I also try to do a little recruiting. And I know one of my goals is to recruit more women to join the FBI. And I think a good way of doing that is to highlight, you know, how different agents got into the FBI. So Nancy, if you could tell us now, when you joined the FBI and why you joined the FBI?
Well, I'm a bureau brat. My dad was an agent. He was in the Navy in World War II, and he came back, and the FBI was hiring. My uncle, his older brother, had already gone to work for the FBI and had worked during World War II. And of course, there's a huge ramp up in FBI responsibilities during wartime because the FBI has responsibility for counterintelligence. And they were definitely working, overtime during World War II. So my uncle was doing that. And when my dad came back, he said, "Hey, the FBI is hiring. Why don't you join up?" My dad said, "Hey, I'll take a shot at that." And he became an FBI agent. And then, of course, like anyone coming back from World War II, my parents started having a family. And seven little savages later, he had a full family, which kind of makes me probably bonded, especially with Bob and his seven kids, because I was one of seven. As a kid, I was always just fascinated with what my dad was doing, probably more than the other children. And I used to go down to work with him in a small resident agency in California on the weekends. And he'd give me little assignments to do while he was typing up reports and that type of thing. You know, as a child, I would ask him to assign me cases, and he would make up cases for me and the next door neighbor boy. And we would go out on strange little investigations and collection operations in the neighborhood. Of course, at that time, I never thought I could be an FBI agent because they weren't allowing women in. I ended up probably pursuing something that I consider about a nickel's worth of difference between an FBI agent. I was going to be a journalist, a photojournalist. And I was pursuing that at UC Berkeley, where I went to school. My dad was working as an agent in San Francisco at the time. And I was on a journalism track. And in the summer, I would go to different summer camps and work at teaching and being a counselor at different summer camps in California. And I would take my horse. So I'd teach horseback riding, and I was certified as a lifeguard. So I'd lifeguard. And then I wanted to get certified as a riflery instructor because you made a little bit more money doing that. And my dad hooked me up with one of the agents in the office who was teaching riflery, and he was helping me get certified with the NRA as a riflery instructor while I was in college. He mentioned to me, and it was a guy named Agent, one of our members named Bob Spencer in San Francisco. He said, "Nancy, why don't you become an FBI agent? We're hiring women now." And it was an epiphany. It was a moment of clarity, and I immediately switched over and said, "This is for me." I think my college roommates thought, "Oh, she's gone off the deep end," but I knew that's what I wanted to do, and that's what I did, and never looked back. And so there you go, Jerry.
Fantastic. And I do have to give a shout out to our mutual friend, Jackie D. I've been trying to get her on the show, and she'll be listening to this.
She's been involved in a lot of great cases. So,
absolutely.
Yeah. So, yeah, we got to get her on.
Yes. I want to make sure that my guests have said everything they wanted to say about the topic that they were on to discuss. And so I give them the last word. What would you like to say?
Well, my deepest condolences go to the Levinson family. I can't imagine, because I grew up so close with my FBI agent dad, just choking up, talking about how they must have felt. The other thing is, I have to say something wonderful about our members. They are relentless at society members about trying to pursue this, pursue legislation, help the family, do anything they can to try to bring Bob home and to help the family out. Also give a big shout out to our FBI directors that have met with the family, and Director Ray has really pushed this. I know the family is very appreciative, and all the FBI agents who worked on this case. Thank you very much.
And that's the end of the interview. At jerrywilliams.com, you'll find a photo of Nancy Savage, lots of links to newspaper articles and videos regarding the disappearance of Bob Levinson, links to the Levinson family's Facebook page and website, and additional photos of Bob and his family. I hope you enjoyed the interview and that you'll share it with your friends, family, and associates. If they're not sure how to listen to a podcast, have them read the post on my website, How to Listen to a Podcast, and subscribe to FBI Retired Case File Review on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app. I would love it if you also check out my books, my nonfiction, FBI Myths and Misconceptions, A Manual for Armchair Detectives, which goes through 20 cliches and misconceptions about the FBI in books, TV, and movies. And there's also my Philadelphia FBI Corruption Squad crime series. All of my books are available wherever books are sold. Please consider leaving a review. Reviews help readers find good books. Thank you for listening to the very end, and I hope you come back again for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.